Jonah says, throw me overboard. He is wanting to flee from God to whatever extent it takes, even to drown. Where are we in that journey from reluctance to true repentance? Sometimes it's subtle. So it might seem a little fishy why I'm breaking up Jamin's sermon on Jude, but we're going to have a whale of a good time. That was for Kono. I threw those in last minute, the dad jokes, you know. When I knew he was coming, I had to work it in somehow. But no, thanks, Jamin, for letting me jump in here. I think it's an appropriate book to talk through as we partook in communion today. It is a mirror book, as Matt Chandler shares. It's not a window book of the Bible to look through and to see how we should do life, but it's more of a mirror book so we can reflect on our own lives. But it's also a book that showcases the radical grace and gives us insights to the God's relentless pursuit of his people. And I feel like that really pairs well with the idea of communion. I'm reflecting on our own hearts and understanding God's pursuit of us. So why Jonah? You know, whenever you preach just randomly, it's kind of hard to pick something and to put it concise. This was, I don't know, 6 months ago. I was doing something for my work, letting all the alumni out there know that they have access to, what's it? Right Now Media, yep. And so I was logging back in, making sure everything still worked, and the first thing that came up was David Platt talking about the series on Jonah. So I was like, oh, that'd be cool. I like David. And so I started watching just a little bit, and then I never went back to it. That was 6 months or so ago. And then it just kept coming up more recently. Alyssa watches our kids sometimes throughout the week, and they had watched the VeggieTales of Jonah. And then at VBS, our kids studied Jonah. And then I started listening to Matt Chandler again randomly out of the blue a couple months ago, and then he was doing a series on Jonah. And I knew this date was coming up, so I was like, well, why not Jonah? So as I've processed this, this has been something for me specifically of, you know, why does Jonah keep popping up? It's not exactly a overly encouraging book to have keep popping up. And so there's a lot of reflection in this. And so I'm going to kind of walk through that reflection corporately today. We're going to jump in. I won't read the whole book, but I'm going to read a lot and paraphrase some. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come up before me. Now, before I keep going, just a little backstory on Jonah. Most of the prophetic books are God's word being shared through his prophets. But this book is a specific story about one of God's prophets. We like to use the phrase in our house, donker, for people who are acting ridiculous. And Jonah, historically, is kind of a donker. I thought my kids would like that one. And so that kind of sets the stage of this story. Nineveh is home to the Assyrians, which is the powerhouse of that age and also the cruelest people of that age, of the ruler, the king, and persecuted the Israelites, which Jonah being one of them. This book is written somewhat in a satire approach. You know, even at the end, the king of Nineveh, his cattle, his livestock even wore sackcloth and repented. It's a big fish. So there's some satirical narratives here. But it's also a look at a compare and contrast. Jonah, our prophet of God, versus the pagans, the mariners, and the Assyrians. Jonah's selfishness versus the pagan pagans' humility and their repentance. So as we read through that, just kind of keep those things in mind. Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come up before me. But Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down, they use that phrase several times in this book, he went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish, away from the presence of the Lord. So at this point, we don't really know why he's fleeing. And if you're like me, when I was doing a deeper dive of this book, all growing up, I thought he was just afraid. That's how I related to the book, just afraid to do stuff. But that's not quite the case, which we'll find out here in a little bit. But the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship threatened to break up. Then the mariners were afraid, and each cried out to his God, and they hurled the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten it for them. But Jonah had gone down into the inner part of the ship and had lain down and was fast asleep. So the captain came to and said to him, "What do you mean, you sleeper? Arise, call out to your God. Perhaps the God will give a thought to us that we may not perish." And they said to one another, "Come, let us cast lots, that we may know on whose account this evil has come upon us." So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Then they said to him, "Tell us on whose account this evil has come upon us. What is your occupation, and where do you come from? What is your country, and of what people are you?" And at this point, you got to think, if mariners, people that this is their profession, they're out on this large sea all the time. If they're throwing their cargo overboard, this must be one doozy of a storm, one to cause them such panic, such fear. And he said to them, "I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven." A little satire there as well. "Who made the sea and the dry land?" Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, "What is this that you have done?" For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord because he had told them. Then they said to him, "What shall we do to you that the sea may quiet down for us?" For the sea grew more and more tempestuous. He said to them, "Pick me up and hurl me into the sea. Then the sea will quiet down for you. For I know it is because of me that this great tempest has come upon you." Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to get back to dry land, but they could not, for the sea grew more and more tempestuous against them. Therefore, they called out to the Lord, "O Lord, let us not perish for this man's life, and lay not unto us innocent blood for you. O Lord, have done as it has pleased you." So they picked up Jonah and hurled him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. And the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. I'm going to summarize chapter 2. So Jonah's in the belly of the fish, and it recounts this prayer of repentance, kind of. It's interesting, the heart posture that Jonah continues to maintain, because he has this repentant heart, but yet he compares, it says right here, "Those who pay regard to vain idols forsake their hope of steadfast love, but I, with the voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you." So even in the belly of a fish, he still has a sense of pride and a almost repentant heart. "And the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah out upon dry land." Now, vomiting, that's not just something that it's like, bleh, you know, that's a projectile type thing that happens there. And so I'm assuming Jonah is probably thinking that he has been saved, and then here he is, right back at the start where he is, where God had called him to be. "Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, 'Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it the message that I tell you.' So Jonah arose and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh, an exceedingly great city, 3 days' journey in breadth. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's journey, and he called out, "Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They called for a fast and put on sackcloth, for the greatest of them to the least of them. The word reached the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, removed his robe, and covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. And he issued a proclamation and published through Nineveh: "By the decree of the king and his nobles, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Let them not feed or drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth, and let them call out mightily to God. Let everyone turn from his evil way and from the violence that is in his hands. Who knows? God may turn and relent and turn from his fierce anger, so that we may not perish." When God saw that what they did, how they turned from their evil way, God relented of the disaster that he had said he would do to them, and he did not do it. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry. So this is where we finally find out why he fled. And he prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is it not this what I said when I was yet in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish, for I knew that you are a gracious God and a merciful God, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster." So he ran because he did not want grace for the people of Nineveh. "Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." So he concludes really in this book, and this is something I didn't really fully understand either. The book kind of ends abruptly. "And should not I pity Nineveh, that great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right from their left hand, and also much cattle?" Question mark. That's how it ends. It ends with Jonah, our prophet of God, still just frustrated. And so that's why this is a mirror book, because it's a story that allows us the opportunity to reflect. So as I go through these, I have some questions that I've been asking myself, and that I'm going to let you all have a moment to pause and ask yourselves as we go through this morning. Am I fleeing from God? Just take a few seconds and just meditate on that question. Am I fleeing from God? If so, why? You know, it's easy to look at this and say, because it is kind of satirical, "Well, that's not me. I'm not running from God like Jonah." But sometimes running from God can be a lot more subtle. Sometimes it can be putting yourself in places and spaces that make it so you can't even hear from God. You kind of numb yourself to what God may be calling you to. Could be binge watching. Could be scrolling. Sometimes it can just be isolating yourself from other people, because it is the community of God that he uses to call his children closer to what he is wanting them to do. It's that idea of wherever you are, there he is. And sometimes it can even be more subtle. Just, you know, oftentimes we're great at hanging out, but we're really good at connecting with people in a way that allows them to pull us out of the muck, that allows them to call out what is happening, to call us out on our running and point us in the right direction. You know, I was telling Kayla this morning, walking through this book, again, I was reflecting a lot, and I have a Bible that my mom and dad gave me when I was baptized, and I looked back at the date. This September marks 25 years since I've been baptized. And in some regard, I've realized that I've been subtly running these past 25 years. Sometimes it's been less subtle than others, but it's been a subtle running. And in these past, I would say more 10 years, I've been slowly learning to be more quick to lean in and to turn back. This church service today, me being up here, is my attempt to run back to God, to stop fleeing. There was a church service. I was in college. I was visiting my brother and my whole family, but I was at my brother's church. And the pastor that morning said, I need to stop what I'm saying because I feel like there's somebody in this space that is being called into ministry. I don't know who it is, but Lord, let them know from you today. And in that day, I felt that was me. That was, I don't know how long ago that was, but I have yet to lean into that calling until recently. And it's really easy to justify, which we'll talk here in a minute. You know, these past years, as that memory comes up, I keep telling myself, you're not really calling me. Look at who I am. I don't read my Bible enough. I'm not intellectual enough. Surely you're not calling me. Next question. To what length am I willing to flee from God? Because for Jonah, you know, I always thought it was more of a heart posture of him thinking of the mariners and just wanting to save their lives. But what could have he have said instead of throw me overboard? What's another option there? Turn the ship around. Do you think the Lord would have not have calmed the seas if Jonah said, yes, I'm the reason, so let's turn the ship around and things will be okay? Nope. Jonah says, throw me overboard. He is wanting to flee from God to whatever extent it takes, even to drown. Where are we in that journey from reluctance to true repentance? Again, sometimes it's subtle. But asking yourself, what length am I doing now to prevent myself from obeying the Lord? Third question, who might I have a hardened heart toward? Are you fleeing from the Lord because you don't think it's fair? I shouldn't have to do that, Lord. They should be the ones. Why are you asking me to be the one to save these people? Why are you the one asking me the one to have the conversation with this person? Are we justifying in our own hearts, continuing to harden them towards the very people God is calling us to? Something I've found, it's easy to join in on that. You know, if you are in close community, sometimes it's you justify outwardly to others, and sometimes we can be the stumbling blocks for those people and saying, yeah, you're right. you shouldn't have to do that. Instead of rebuking them, having that courage. Next question. What is my heart posture when I decide to be obedient? That's the end of the book that we realize why Jonah is running. And even when he gets spewed back out on the sea for a second chance and he obeys, he's angry about it. He asks God, just kill me now. The fact that you are willing to save these people, it disgusts him. He's angry at the Lord that he would have mercy on a people that have persecuted his people. So where is our heart posture? Is it one of love? Is it one of frustration? I like the part where it says, and the Lord said, do you do well to be angry? He says that twice to Jonah. Kind of like that idea Matt Chandler said, how's that going for you, being angry? Oftentimes it doesn't go well. Am I fooling myself? Fifth question here. Now Jonah, when he asked who he was, why is he fleeing? I am a Hebrew who fears the Lord. No, he doesn't. If he feared the Lord, why is he on the ship? If he feared the Lord, why is he saying, throw me overboard? Oftentimes when we say the right things over and over, we get caught in this idea that even in the midst of us running, we can fool ourselves. Which leads us to a sense of pride and deceit. Do you ever find yourself saying the right things, truly believing what you think? But are our actions matching up? Again, that was, I think, me all these years trying to fool myself into believing that I'm not being called to something. I still don't know what that looks like. Even as I prep, you know, this is the second time I've gotten to do this. Even as I prep, sometimes I ask myself, why do you think you can be up here? Those seeds of doubt are another way of running. But really, when we look at this book, it's not really about Jonah. It's not really about the king of Nineveh, the Assyrians, the mariners. It's this consistent story of God's grace and his pursuit of his people. For Jonah, God had a lot of grace. God pursued him well. And obviously, for the mariners, he had grace there. For the people of Nineveh, that's why Jonah was angry. You know, a little side note here is just a lot that we can learn from loving our enemies and the difficulty that lies there. But I think it's a neat picture, this book, of how even in the New Testament, how oftentimes the confusion of God's people, of Jonah, a prophet, that still is angry or doesn't understand the grace of God that wants all people to know him. God is a pursuing God. He went to great lengths to turn Jonah around. He went to great lengths for the people of Nineveh. We also see this in the story of the prodigal son. You know, I comparatively, this idea of being pursued by God doesn't mean you won't go through times of discipline. 3 days in the belly for the prodigal son being eating the muck, pig muck. But that picture of him waiting every day, and when he sees his son from far off, that pursuit. We see it in Jesus on the cross. Kayla and I have loved watching the Chosen series, and it really puts this personal experience and the love in which he has and the great lengths he's willing to go, but yet the burden that Christ carried through that time. And also realizing that God pursues people through people. It's us. You know, God can, he could have done that differently with the Ninevites. But he wanted to use one of his people to do it. So a quick story. And I'll wrap up here. The kind of blends the two together. It was a spare room one night, a Wednesday night, and it was a frustrating day. I was not in a great headspace, and I didn't really want to be in worship. I thought about not going. Oftentimes, Kayla and I get to go together if we find a sitter, but sometimes we don't, and so we rotate, and that was an easy out for me. We didn't have a sitter, but I thought, no, I should go. But I was still frustrated. Still felt like running from his presence. And in that space, as we got started, my heart started to soften a little bit. And it was this curiosity mixed with gladness, mixed with boldness, and still slight frustration. A lot of emotions. I said, God, give me a word tonight. Let me know that you see me. And, you know, I've never had anything like that happen to me before. And so I was understanding that. I said, seriously, in my mind, I was like, seriously, I want you to give me a word tonight. Then we start, you know, my heart continues to soften. And partway through, I look up at somebody who's not normally there, but somebody who I have a great deal of respect for. I didn't ask this person, so I won't name them. But I smiled to myself and I said, you know what, Lord? No, I want you to give a word for me through this person. I really wanted it that night. In my frustration. So the evening wraps up. We have a time where we can share if we had anything put on our hearts. Nothing. I just smiled to myself. I thought, that's okay, God. By that time, my heart had softened quite a bit. And as we start walking out, I was about right over there. That person says, hey, Brian, wait a second. And I smiled to myself. And she said, I think Jesus had a word for you tonight. I smiled. I said, oh, really? She goes, yeah, but it's not one I really want to share. I just smiled bigger. And she said, why are you smiling? I was like, I'll tell you in a minute. And she said, as I was worshiping, I got a picture of a Charlie Brown Christmas tree. And I felt Jesus saying, this is for Brian. And that's exactly how I felt that day. I felt like a Charlie Brown Christmas tree. I couldn't have summed it up better myself. So this idea of even in frustration, pursuing, turning around, turning the ship around. But also, she almost didn't share that night. She had her own doubts, fears of making me upset, or just that's a weird thing to share with somebody. But she did it anyway. She was obedient. So I'll close. Brian, I promise this isn't one of those chapel speakers that says I'll close 10 times with Lamentations 3:22. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Let us turn into his pursuit. Let us turn the ship around and meet him, meet his embrace that he desperately wants to give us.